We'll tell the story with the Gospel of Matthew this morning. I invite you to please stand as you're able in honor of a reading of the Gospel of Jesus Christ. The lesson comes today from the very end of Matthew's Gospel, just as after Jesus was resurrected and appeared to the women at the tomb. We have this scene. It begins with verse 16. It says, "Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee and to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and he said to them, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me.' Jesus said, 'Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teach them to obey everything I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, even to the end of the age.'" This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Well, dear friends in Christ, grace to you and peace from God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. If you didn't know it, there is a congregation that meets behind prison bars, right here in Sioux Falls. The congregation's name is St. Dismas. Some of you have maybe worshipped there before, but St. Dismas is served right now by a pastor named Wayne Gallipo. Apparently, he's good friends with Pastor Sarah or something. She just knows everybody. So Pastor Wayne has been serving them. He grew up in Aberdeen, but he's been serving this congregation faithfully for a few years now. And I've been getting to know him over the past couple of years, and he's shared with me some of the unique things that he has to deal with as a pastor. It's something that the two of us probably have never had to experience before. His issues, the pastoral issues that he deals with are really unique. And one of the issues that he was telling me about is this issue of reentry. He said, you know, a lot of these men, as they're coming out of prison, are afraid. They're fearful. They have no idea what's next for them. They have very little idea about where to go or what to do next. They have oftentimes no friends or family because of what they've done or the ways that they've behaved in the past. They have basically alienated themselves from anyone. And so they lose just about everything they have because of their mistakes. And all of a sudden, they find themselves released from prison and then they've got nothing. So Pastor Wayne was telling me a story recently about a man that he met not long after he started as the pastor of St. Dismas. This man was kind of an older gentleman. He was about 70 years old, but he had served a 30-year prison sentence. And you can probably imagine the kind of thing that he had to do to get him in prison for 30 years. And like many of the other men who are released from prison, he had no family, he had no friends, he had nothing left after 30 years. And so he gathered his worldly possessions from the box that the Department of Corrections had kept for him for 30 years. The only things in there, some clothes, the clothes that he had when he came in, and a wallet with an expired driver's license. He had nothing else. He stepped out of the prison doors and he was free. He was free to go for the very first time in 30 years. And as he left, the state handed him a check for $50, which of course he couldn't cash because he had no bank account. So he looked at the prison guard standing there at the gate and he said, "What am I supposed to do with this? How am I going to get this check cashed?" And the prison guard said, "I don't know. Maybe you could go down to the gas station and maybe they'll cash it for you. Why don't you go and see? It's just down the hill." So the man started walking down the hill. Thankfully, that prison guard had a little bit of heart. And he looked at that older gentleman walking down the road with absolutely nothing. And he decided to call Pastor Wayne and ask him for help. So Pastor Wayne gets in his car. He drives to the gas station to meet this man. He kind of wonders, well, how am I going to find him? But as soon as he pulls up, he knows exactly who he's looking for. Here's this man sitting on the curb, looking about as lost as he ever could be, and he's got a bottle of Dr. Pepper. Pastor Wayne pulls up and he says, hey, heard you just got out. Can you tell me how you got that bottle of pop? The guy said, well, I walked into the gas station and I asked the guy at the register if he could cash my check for me. And he said, sure, but you got to buy something. So the guy said, well, what should I buy? And the clerk said, I don't know. Why don't you buy a bottle of pop? So he grabs the Dr. Pepper out of the cooler, sets it on the counter. The clerk pushes a few buttons on the register and says, that'll be $1.65. And the guy's jaw just about hit the floor. He said, sir, I am not buying a six-pack. 30 years ago, you could buy a six-pack with $1.65. And now he's trying to buy a bottle of soda. Can you imagine what it's like to get out of prison, a place that you've been stuck 30 years, having no contact with the outside world? Can you imagine you went into prison and when you went in, phones had curly cords on them, right? Now all of a sudden people are walking around with phones that are attached to their ears, basically. Can you imagine what kind of, how disorienting that might be to have that kind of freedom for the very first time in 30 years, to be free to go? Somebody just opens up the doors and says, time to go. Get out. Move. Can you imagine how terrifying that must be? Freedom, I think, can be terrifying. I want you to think about that with me for a minute. I want you to think about the fact that maybe freedom, true freedom, real freedom, is not as good at first as we might like to think. Maybe it's disorienting or scary or terrifying. And I want you to think about your life of faith with me. As a Christian, we are, because of Jesus Christ on the cross, free, right? We are free from the powers of sin. We are free from the powers of death. We are free from the powers of evil. We are free because of what Jesus has done for us on the cross. We know that. We hear it week after week after week, and we sometimes take that freedom a little lightly and maybe kind of walk out the doors and not think about it the rest of the week. But I want to think about that word freedom. You know, our mission statement, we've been covering that the last couple of weeks. Our mission statement at Gloria Day, freed by Christ, we gather, grow, give, and go, all to the glory of God, right? It's a great mission statement, but I wonder sometimes if the hardest part for us is that little word, freed. Because I think real freedom is disorienting. It's scary. We don't know exactly what to do with it. We're just not sure about what we are supposed to do now. All of a sudden, the pastor says, in Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free. And now what? Scary. Or at least it was for the first disciples. From our story for today, Jesus meets his disciples up on a mountain in Galilee. It's the first time that they've seen Jesus since they saw him on the cross and buried his body in the tomb. It's the first time that they've laid eyes on him. They thought he was dead, and now all of a sudden, he's standing right before them. And some of them believe and worship right away, and others don't trust their eyes and they doubt. Now, those disciples, they took Jesus' own body down from the cross themselves, and they put it in the tomb, and they rolled that heavy stone tight against the opening. Now, all of a sudden, Jesus is here. He's standing right in front of them. He's up on his own two feet, walking along beside them. Can you imagine what kind of shock they must have been experiencing? Jesus is free, not only from the tomb, but from death itself. And that means something. It means for them that death did not win, sin did not win, evil did not win. Jesus did. Because he is free, and so are they. And so are we. Friends, we are freed by Christ. We are freed by Christ from the powers of death. We are freed by Christ from the powers of sin. We are freed by Christ from the powers of evil. Those things, they have no hold on your lives anymore. All of the bad things that you've done, the mistakes you've made, the things you didn't do but should have, free. Death, it's not in front of you, it's behind you. Evil, the devil can do nothing to you. You have been freed by Christ. And for the first disciples, the very first thing that they do and hear from Jesus with this newfound freedom is Jesus gives them one little word, one small command, one thing he wants them to do, and that is the word, go. Go, therefore, he says, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach them to obey everything I have commanded. Remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. Get up and go, Jesus says. Get on your feet. Stop feeling sorry for yourself. Stop worrying about the sin. Stop worrying about my death. Stop worrying about the evil in this world. It has no power over you anymore. Get up and go, Jesus says. Because he wants his disciples, he wants you to know that the most important thing that you have in your toolbox to share the good news, the most important thing that you have to evangelize, to tell the good news about Jesus, is not your lips, but your feet. Your feet. Our lesson from Romans says, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring the good news. People can't know about Jesus. They can't know about that freedom unless you've gone and brought it to them. I know probably many of you, your feet are not working too well these days. Maybe you're in a wheelchair, or you've got a walker, or you've got crutches, or you've got a cane or something. Maybe your feet are sore from constantly standing at work all day, but Jesus doesn't care. He says, well, give yourself a foot bath. Get in a wheelchair, get some crutches, get a walker. I don't care. I want you to get up and go, Jesus says. You have no excuse. You are free in Christ. Stand up, walk, move, roll, whatever you have to do. Bring this good news to the world. I wore my sneakers today. Maybe you heard them kind of squeaking around up here. But I wore them for a reason, because I think we need to wear running shoes to church. I'm serious. I think we need to wear running shoes to church because we are free in Christ. He has given us freedom, and we need to tie those laces tight, and we need to pick up that good news and run with it, Jesus says. I want to put a slide up for you. This slide, you might recognize this. It's our logo for all of our mission and outreach things we do here at church. If you haven't seen this before, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about this, but what's the first word that you see in this slide? What is it? Go, right? Jesus says go. At the center of mission and outreach at Gloria Day, at the center of all the things we do outside of the walls is the Word of God. Jesus commands his disciples, go therefore. Matthew 28, he says go. Behind that, you can see the faces, right? All the faces of God's people. This is you. Every tribe, every tongue, every nation, black, white, men, women, young, old, rich, poor, perfectly able, differently abled, it doesn't matter. Everyone has been freed in Christ and commanded to go. All of us together. We are the church together. We belong to each other, and Jesus has called us. And out in front of that, those white circles, those circles represent the world. The world that we're called to go into and to serve. At the very center of those circles is your family. Jesus calls each of you to go first to your mother, your father, to your children, to your siblings, your aunts, your uncles, your grandparents. Jesus says, the first thing I want you to do is go and serve your family. The next circle outside of that represents your neighborhood. Maybe the city of Sioux Falls. I know that it's hard to carry this good news into the world, that it's difficult, that sometimes it's a challenge to share your faith in the world. But Jesus commands us, he asks us, he frees us to do that, and he sends us out into the world. And at Gloria Day, we have lots of ways to help you do that. We have the banquet coming up. You can sign up on the kiosk or online. We've got St. Francis House going every month. You can do that there. I was just meeting with a confirmation student the other day. We're getting ready for students to be confirmed, and I met Kennedy Veland, and Kennedy is going to be confirmed at the end of October, and she's got this great project that she's doing right here in Sioux Falls. She said, you know, Pastor Chris, I was worried about young women who have chronic illnesses and diseases who are struggling, and so I wanted to put care packages together. I call them heart care boxes. She said, would you ever put a box out for people to donate items for care packages for young women who are in need? And I said, absolutely. And so guess what? There are boxes outside the youth room and by the front doors. Jesus calls us to go right here in our own community. We've got a new partnership starting up with St. Dismas, actually, to help men like the one from Pastor Wayne's story, men who are being released from prison. We've got five men from our men's Bible study who are all ready to go. They're going to be trained soon to help men as they're released from prison begin to get their feet back underneath them, to get a job, to get a place to live, to begin to enter back into society, to find a community of faith. We're hoping a community like Gloria Day, but we've got a group of guys, and we'd love to have more. So if you're interested, send me an email, and we can get you connected with that. We have lots of ways right here in our own neighborhood to go and share the love of Christ. We got ways around the state of South Dakota. Right now, we're forming a new partnership with a ministry out on Pine Ridge. It's the Pine Ridge Retreat Center. Their pastor, Pastor Kay, invites groups from churches all around the state to come and learn about what it means to be born, to grow up, to live out on Pine Ridge. I'm hoping to get a group of members of Gloria Day, maybe that's you, to come out there with me this winter. We're called to go not only in the state of South Dakota, but around the country. We've got places like Appalachia, Clendenin, West Virginia. 12 of us are going to the hills and hollers out there, to a community that's been kicked in the teeth just one too many times. We've got an economic nightmare going on because their coal mines closed and people lost jobs and there's nothing left for them. And then 2 years ago, they were hit with a devastating flood and everything that they had was wiped out. And so in a few weeks, we're going to be going there. Like I said, we're collecting money right now if you want to donate to that so you can go in that way. We'd love to have you be a part of it. Hygiene kits and turkey baskets as we go around and meet people in the communities. That last ring on the outer circle is, of course, the whole world. Jesus calls us to share the good news in Jerusalem, in Judea, and to all the ends of the earth. You know, we serve in Nicaragua once a year. Unfortunately, I don't think we're going this year because of violence and unrest in the country, but we're reaching out to the partner church that we have there, the Lutheran Church, and we've talked with the bishop, and her staff, and we're trying to learn ways to partner together with them and be a part of their outreach and mission into their communities as we sit here and pray for them and wonder what's in store for the future. We're going to get ready to send a team as soon as we can down to Nicaragua. Friends, Jesus Christ has freed us. I know I'm getting long here, but hang with me. He has freed us to go. You have been freed by Christ to go out into the world, so I'm going to keep my shoes laced up. I want you to wear running shoes to church next week so that you can go to, with all this mission and outreach stuff going on, you have me running and I want you to run with me. I want to keep our laces tied tight and I hope that you do too. I know it's hard. I know it's hard to know just what to do with your faith now that Jesus Christ has freed you, but that's why we're here. That's why we're church together. We belong to each other. We can do this together. We are freed by Christ, and we gather, we grow, we give, we go, all to the glory of God. So Gloria Day, let's lace him up. Let's go in Jesus' name. Amen. May the peace of God, that peace that passes all our understanding, guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.